Loss comes in many forms, and usually in unexpected ways. It can be devastating, leaving you facing an uphill struggle to go on with life without someone you thought would always be there. But life does go on, and even in the deepest despair, we can find hope. Welcome to Grief Relief with your hosts, Drs. Gloria and Heidi Horsley, brought to you by the Open to Hope Foundation, helping people find hope after loss. And now here's Dr. Gloria and Dr. Heidi.
Welcome to the Grief Relief Show. I'm your host, Dr. Gloria Horsley, with my co-host and daughter, Dr. Heidi Horsley.
Hi, Mom.
Hi. Well, we got a great show today and some wonderful people on.
We do.
And we've got such an important topic. We're going to be talking about forgiveness today. And that is such a key to healing after you've had a loss. So we've got Fred Luskin on, and he's with the Forgiveness Project in Stanford. And you know, Heidi, Fred's really been there. He's lost a daughter in an automobile accident, and his wife died several years ago. So he's a person who's been there and knows what he's talking about. And besides that, he has got such a rich history of talking about forgiveness and teaching at Stanford. So you're going to get a lot out of this.
He does, Mom. I just want to say something about Dr. Fred Luskin, because I worked with firefighter families after 9/11 for many, many years, and there was a lot of anger. And I called Fred once and talked to him a lot about, you know, I was doing these groups with these families and they were angry and they were having a hard time with forgiveness, and he gave me a lot of good insight, and we'll talk a lot today about it. So I appreciated him taking the time.
Yeah, I'm really excited about having him here. And then Rhoda Stearns is going to be with us, and she has been on one of our other shows talking, I think it was a show on murder, because her son Christopher was murdered. And I asked Rhoda to be here today because one of the things that I think is really important for you and for many people is the fact that the person who murdered Rhoda's son Christopher has not been contrite, he hasn't asked for her forgiveness, and how has she dealt with this? So we want her to come on and talk about that also.
Yes, she has such a powerful personal story, and today she also works in San Quentin with people that have, committed murders.
Right, and having them look at their impact.
Yes, absolutely.
On families. So what a great service she's doing and an outreach. So, and both of these people have written books. Rhoda's written one called Grief Prince, and Fred has written one called Forgive for Good. So I hope that you'll
and
also
you
look
have
for
Rhoda's
those.
Book.
Yeah, I've got Rhoda's book right here on Grief Prince.
There you go.
Here's a book that she's written, and I think you'll get a lot out of that. And then, as I said, in Fred's book, Forgive for Good. Well, let's get started. Welcome, Dr. Fred Luskin.
Hi.
Hi, Fred.
Hi there.
We're so glad to have you on the show today, because as I said to you earlier when we were talking, forgiveness seems to be a place where people get stuck. Particularly when they've had a loss. There are people that they're angry at. They're angry at doctors. They're angry at hospices. They're angry at other family members. I mean, they're angry at people who were driving the car when somebody was killed. They're angry, you know, there are just so many angers. And I see, Heidi and I do a lot with the Compassionate Friends, and we see people way out there, maybe 10 years, they're still talking about what somebody did to them.
And they also get really angry at the idea or concept or even word forgiveness.
Yeah,
that's true.
Right. Oh, I'm not going to forgive. I don't have to forgive. Don't tell me that.
I've had many people say, your ideas are good. I wish you had a better name for it. I don't like forgiveness. There's something very challenging about thinking that I myself can be harmed, and yet down the road that's not going to be my story anymore, that I'm not going to identify around it. And one of the ways we resist that is by blaming people and by just holding on tight to our pain. And forgiveness is, you know, and I've had to do it myself, is this way of saying, like, really painful things happen, and then you move on because life moves on.
Is there a time frame with forgiveness? You know, if how long do I have to, when do I have to forgive?
Well, you have to forgive when you die, because it all goes away anyway.
Right.
Up until then, you have some choice. In the deeper question that you're asking is, different offenses require more time, depending upon the degree of harm that's been done. So if somebody cuts you off on the freeway, you may be angry legitimately for 10 seconds. If somebody fires you from a job, you may be angry for, you know, 10 days. if somebody really harms you again, hurts one of your children, mm-hmm. the legitimate anger may be 6 months or a year or so. But after a while, unfortunately, because of the way our brain is wired, if we continue to repeat the same old thoughts and feelings of how terrible it is, they create pathways that we can't get out of. Mm-hmm. And then we become a prisoner of our own negativity.
Mm-hmm. And those are really neurological pathways that can be seen. Can they be seen when the brain is lit up?
I don't know if you can see the pathways, but you can see different areas light up depending on the intensity of certain things. Pathways is a sense of understanding that neurons in our brain coordinate to activate depending on the kind of stimulus. So if you're happy, then it's a certain sequence of neurons. If you're angry, it's a different sequence. But once you have an embedded sequence, the purpose is to make it so they don't have to think much about it, and you can just get upset about it.
Right.
So if I don't like you and I see you, I don't want to have to think every time what you did that's terrible. So my brain quickly, almost instantaneous, remembers Heidi bad and mm-hmm. gets me upset.
Mm. Well, and I think one of the issues with that would be, I would imagine if you're in that negativity, it would wreak havoc on your relationships and on your health.
Yeah, on both.
Okay.
And the simplest way of understanding it in terms of health is that every time you have that response, your body's under tremendous stress.
Mm-hmm.
And stress just wears out whatever part of your body is the weakest.
Mm-hmm.
The more subtle thing is on your relationships, both mm-hmm. with your relationship to yourself and your relationship to other people, but even more deeply on your relationship to life, that if I've been harmed and I can't get past it, then one, I feel a loss of power in myself that I couldn't cope with something. But two, I carry around a sense of mistrust mm-hmm. that somehow life is going to continue to harm me and I can't deal with it. Mm-hmm. And so both of those are very corrosive.
Okay, now I'm hearing you and I'm thinking, I am angry and somebody's, you know, the hospital or somebody was driving a car or mm-hmm. somebody hit one of my family members. Maybe it's been a while, and maybe it's time that I thought about this process. And I was just looking on your website. I know you have a lot of points on forgiveness. And can you talk about, I was really struck by one where you said that forgiveness isn't necessarily reconciliation.
Right. They're two separate things. Forgiveness is an inner kind of quality of letting go. Reconciliation involves another person.
Mm-hmm.
So you can forgive somebody and never see them, and you can move back into their house and still hate them.
Mm-hmm.
So they're independent constructs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so if I don't have to reconcile with them.
No. And in fact, sometimes it's smarter not to.
Oh, you mean I can forgive them without reconciling?
Sometimes it's not safe.
Right. Okay.
You know, the most poignant examples of those I get often are like 23-year-old women who finally get out of an abusive father's mm-hmm. home and know they have to let this stuff go to be able to move on and have a life, but they still don't feel safe going back to dad.
Right.
And that's totally legit.
Right. And you don't have to work that out.
No.
You don't have to go back.
I mean,
you don't have to find that.
You have to keep yourself safe as well as open-hearted.
That's so is it really forgiving the person or forgiving the act? I'm confused.
You know, sometimes it's just forgiving life for being what it is.
Okay.
Unpredictable, dangerous at times, like insensitive to what we want. Sometimes it's just that. Sometimes it's, if you have a relationship with somebody, it's grappling with how could they do this. And sometimes it's an act or a specific thing that's so difficult and so harsh that you have to come to grips with that. There's no one experience of it.
Okay, this is helpful for me because I just think of I'm going to take 9/11 as an example since I live in New York and have been immersed in with working with the firefighter families. They just felt like there was no way they could ever forgive the terrorists.
I understand.
But it sounds like that's not, they can still be in forgiveness without forgiving the terrorists, right? Is that true?
If they're stuck on forgiving the terrorists and they make a conscious or they're taught just leave the terrorists alone,
mm-hmm.
but forgive life.
Okay.
Just forgive the fact that life has suffering and difficulty that you don't understand and let it go.
I like this idea.
Yeah,
forgiving life.
Yep.
Yeah.
Now, one of the things you talked about, too, is as soon as you get upset, Mm-hmm. You can practice a stress technique.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What is it?
Yeah, I want
to see
this.
Matter, but the easiest one is just to take a couple of breaths, slow okay. breaths.
And I notice you're holding your stomach. Mm-hmm. Do I want to do that?
Yeah, just allow your belly to relax and breathe a little more deeply.
Mm. Okay.
And open your belly when you breathe.
Mm-hmm.
So not this, but that.
Like that. Okay. Kind of sticking it out.
And if you want to make it deeper, just while you're breathing, like just think of someone you love.
Mm.
Just picture someone you love while you're breathing.
Mm-hmm. I like that.
And you calm down.
And you're saying immediately, as soon as you feel it coming on.
And from the explanation is you're counter conditioning the stress response. So since we have neural pathways that link our distress and something painful, we have a conditioned response. The second that painful thing comes up,
and
what you're doing is counter conditioning that. You're pairing the stimulus now with a pleasant response, and the conditioned response goes away.
Yeah. And just practice doing that. I like the idea as soon as you get upset. Mm-hmm. And then you were talking about, also I was reading about giving up, expecting things from other people or from life.
The key word is expectation.
Okay.
When I expect anything to just be the way I want it to be, the world doesn't conform to that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually at the basis of unforgiveness. The world didn't give me what I expected.
Mm.
That's the key issue of forgiveness.
Okay. And one last thing I liked was where you said amend your grievance story to talk about your heroic activities. Talk about that a little bit.
At this point now, I understand that forgiveness is simply coming up with a different story to talk about your own life. So one story is that person was terrible. They meant to hurt me. It was awful. I don't know what the heck was wrong with them. I hate them. You have a story mm-hmm. like that. You just have to shift the story a little bit into people hurt each other.
Mm-hmm.
I was slammed. I had no idea what to do with it. I'm learning mm-hmm. how to deal with it. I wish they hadn't done it. People do all sorts of sick and crazy things. I've got to let this go. That's just a shift of story.
Mm-hmm.
I now understand that that's what forgiveness is. It's changing the story.
I like that, Fred. Well, I know you know Rhoda Stern because you've done some projects with her. So let's welcome her on the show, Heidi.
Hi, Rhoda.
Hi, Rhoda.
Nice to see you.
Hello, hello.
Great
Hi.
To have
you on the show. Thanks so much for coming
you
on.
You too. Hi, Fred.
Nice to see you.
So, Rhoda, talk a little bit about your story. We've had you on before. Christopher was murdered by a roommate just for putting dishes in the wrong cabinet.
Right. So that was 17 years ago. And I just kept nodding my head listening to Fred because, done that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's like you do it for yourself first. Well, first of all, you know, Chris was murdered and my life changed in a few seconds. It was mm-hmm. absolutely tragic. I was a puddle on the floor. And it's just, you know, I knew instinctively very quickly that I didn't want to let this event ruin my life, that I had so much to live for.
Mm-hmm.
And so I instinctively came up with that, or, you know, it was given to me from above. I'm not sure, but it was very clear. And not that I didn't want to just live either. I wanted to thrive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wanted to have a better life than I did before. And that has happened.
That's amazing. I have to say,
I know.
A better life than I had before.
I love hearing this.
Yeah. And it's also a way I can honor Chris because
mm-hmm.
he had a very short life. You know, I'm fortunate to have a longer life than he is. And so there's so much to live for. You know, I didn't want to walk around as an angry, mean person. You know, I just it's not in my personality. And so.
And I love the idea of you honoring him.
Yeah.
And honoring his memory and his spirit and his energy.
Yeah, he doesn't want me down here miserable.
Mm-hmm.
He wants me to have the best life I can possibly have.
But how did you deal with the fact that the person who murdered him was never got it?
That's hard.
I mean, we want them to say they're sorry. We
right.
want
yeah.
the doctor who didn't show up, who at the emergency room or whatever, or screwed up. We want a letter from him. We want him disbarred. You know, we want consequences.
Or the kid that shot Chris, right?
Right.
His roommate.
Right.
And
yeah.
doesn't have any remorse at this
he
point.
He did go to jail, but he's still not remorseful. Right.
Right. Well, first of all, I had to do it for myself. I felt like I was put into a relationship against my will, you know, with the perpetrator, Mark mm-hmm. James Taylor.
Mm-hmm.
And that I had to come up with a place that I was comfortable with this relationship, because, you know, every anniversary, every birthday, every time I think about Chris, he comes into my mind because he took this most precious thing from me. So I had to find a place in myself where I could have this relationship be peaceful. So mm-hmm. the first thing I did was forgive the event. It was like I had to, you know, find a way to digest it so it was soulful. I sat down with him and had a victim offender dialogue that was very formal. And I left there. My mother always used to say, Radha, give people the benefit of the doubt. And I didn't really know who he was. I knew who I thought he was, but I wasn't sure. So when I sat down with him, I came away with a fresh report card. His grades hadn't changed. And I realized, okay, he's in probably going to be in prison for the rest of his life because of him, not because of me.
Right.
And that gave me sort of a sense of freedom that I wasn't in charge. I just had to let go. And, you know, the forgiveness came way before that, but that was sort of like the last thing I felt like I had to do to investigate more. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a friend say once, which was interesting, someone we had on the show, who said, you're always going to have these people at the table with you, and the question is, what will you feed them?
Yes.
Or will you feed them?
Yeah.
Will you feed them hate and anger, or will you just...
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had a dream that he came to my door and rang the doorbell, and of course that won't happen because he's in prison, and that he said he was sorry, but that was a dream. It wasn't a reality. So, but... you know, I don't feel stuck on what's happening with him anymore. I feel like, you know, I'm here, I'm living, I'm doing good things, and Chris is happy and I'm happy.
Now, let me say one thing. He went to jail.
Yes.
So he did get, you might say, we got some justice. But what about people who get no justice, who they, you know, how do you forgive when somebody screwed up, like a doctor or a nurse, or, you know, how do you,
I think you have to do it for yourself, that, you know, you're not in control of that person. I mean, maybe you feel like it was a misjustice, but I mean, you have a choice. You know, I have a choice to have a pleasant, wonderful life or to be depressed for the rest of it and, you know, stay in bed. And I think I choose one. And I think the alternative is crappy. So, I mean, I think you do it for yourself first, and then if you can have that other bridge, then you're fortunate, but you're not always going to get that.
Yeah.
So you have to have your own sort of self-assurance and that I deserve this. For me, there was absolutely no choice. It was just like, yeah.
And it sounds like what you're saying, too, is, you know, you're giving this person a lot of power if you're letting them continue to destroy your life, right?
Yeah, and actually, a friend of mine who was an attorney said that to me. He said, Radha, don't let this person take more than they've already taken from you.
Mm-hmm.
Don't not go on vacation. Don't not throw a birthday party for your daughter. Don't, you know, just, he's already taken much more than he was ever privileged to do so. Mm-hmm. So don't give him any more.
Yeah.
And I thought that was really, really great news.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's just happened to me. How long is it going to take me to get to where you are? I like where you are. Help me. How long?
Well, one of the great joys in my life now is that I feel like, and people have told me this, that I represent hope for them because they see their fresh grief, and you know how horrible that is. It's just awful.
So
they see me smiling, having a positive life, and they know that that is somewhere up, you know, around the corner for them, maybe, you know, and everybody does it differently. Everybody is unique in their grief. But I've helped a lot of families, and this one gentleman sticks in my mind because he met me and he met this other person to kind of be a counselor for him. And he goes, I want to work with you, Radha, because I want to be like you in a few years. I don't want to be like this other person who wasn't getting out of bed.
Right.
And so I think if I can help anybody a titch along the road, you know, I'll do it. That's what the book was about. That's kind of how I'm living my life right now.
Well, and it is so powerful because I'm thinking here you and Fred have both had children die and you're both living life to its fullest and, you know, doing great things with your life. And we need, and my mom lost a child and I lost a sibling, people that are early on in grief need those lifelines.
Oh, yes.
To say, okay, they've done it and made it, we can make it too, eventually.
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah. yes. So, you know, I feel privileged to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I feel a responsibility to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because we have walked in those shoes, so let's help people who are new to them. You know?
Right.
Well, let's talk to you both about what you guys have been doing together. You've done a movie together or
a documentary. Film, yes.
Documentary. And where were
Unlikely
people...
Friends.
Unlikely Friends.
She was featured in it. I had about 20 seconds.
Yeah. Well, actually, when they came to me, you know, to do the documentary, they were highlighting people who had made friends with their perpetrators, and I said, I'm not a good candidate. You know, I said, if I were you, I'd put in both sides of the story, you know, because I think I don't like one-sided documentaries. Okay. And they did, and I appreciate it. They came back to me a few months later and put me in, and that's the first time I had seen Fred, mm-hmm. and I was just like, I got to meet him.
You know, there is something about this idea of models and mm-hmm. exemplars. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, that may be a stuffy academic way of saying that we need to see people who have succeeded mm-hmm. in the task ahead of us. And too often, people practice, like, victimness together. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not going to succeed, so I'm going to find other people who aren't going to succeed, and we're going to reinforce each other's smallness. Mm-hmm. And psychologically speaking, it's much healthier to look for models who have done really well and do everything you can to learn about how they did that, how they were successful, so that we can learn from them rather than keep each other small together. Mm-hmm. And there's a tension in that because often, you know, it's comfortable using a wound to explain why we don't have a full life.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's necessary for a while in the grief process, mm-hmm. but that has to ebb.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Makes total sense to me.
Yeah, I heard somebody once say, you know, I felt like I held on to the pain too long because that was the only thing I had left of the person.
I know.
And I was afraid if I let go of the pain, I would let go of the person.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's, they're very separate. That's not
right.
true. Yeah. I've also seen people who kind of, something terrible happens to them, they think that's going to save their life, which was already messed up anyway. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it is two separate things. You have to work on them both, you know. And together, that's kind of hard, but it's just, oh.
Early on, it can be like one big hole where your whole life, just everything that happens to you just goes into that.
Yeah.
Until you pull yourself out of it. I think in that early grief, anything, you know, if you stub your toe or wreck your car, anything that happens is part of I'm in grief.
You know, well, right, you're now. So raw. So, it's everything is so hard.
Well, listen, I want to thank you both for all the work you do and for being on the show and everything. And I hope that we'll see lots more of both of you.
Yeah, thank you. This is such an important topic for so many. We appreciate you guys being on.
Yeah, our pleasure.
Do. Thank you.
And thanks for everybody watching the show. And we are going to have a song now by Peter Anderson and Randy Cookson on the keyboard. And Peter's going to sing Angel. And he wrote the words and the music, and we're delighted to have them on it.
Thank you. Lord, send me an angel. Sent her when I was down. Taught me to love her. Kept my feet on the ground. I call her angel. Thank you.
I call her Angel. She could walk on gossamer, make the clouds look so dull. She had wings, I'd call her angel. Isn't life wonderful? I call her Angel. Walk on gossamer, she make me look so full. If we had wings, we'd both be angels. Isn't life wonderful? I'd call us angels. Mm-hmm.